History has proven beyond any doubt that the free enterprise that freedom produces provides more for anyone willing to work than any other system. So why would the left still be pushing their socialist agenda on us? I mean, it's really just microwave communism. There's only two possibilities. They're either ignorant or they're evil. From my investigation over the last 2 years into what has caused America's drastic decline, I'm sorry to say the left won't be able to use the ignorant card. They've left too much evidence of their agenda in their books, articles, and speeches. No, America has an enemy that is getting very close to accomplishing its plan of destroying the greatest country in all world history.
Once people figure it out, they're going to do what people everywhere do. They're going to start protesting. They're going to start revolting. And when that happens, that's when the powers that be feel threatened and they use the power that they have.
Split over differences of how to best take America down. Some were wanting to still work toward a violent revolution, while others were wanting to focus their efforts on using public policy to subvert America from the inside. He was curious what they had to say. I mean, after all, the Berlin Wall had just come down, the Soviet Union had dissolved, and the whole world was saying, communism is dead. So why were they meeting, and what were they up to? I was in graduate school at the time, and the whole idea of slipping in undercover to a communist meeting sounded pretty neat, so I decided to go. The first surprise I had was when I walked into the auditorium. I was expecting it to be filled with college radicals, but instead it was 50, 60, and 70-year-olds, I mean grandparents, professionally dressed with briefcases. And I realized this might be a little more serious than I thought. As the weekend unfolded, I listened carefully as they outlined their plan and agenda and how they were going to infiltrate the institutions of America to influence us in the direction they wanted us to go. To destroy our families, they wanted to promote cohabitation instead of marriage. They wanted to try to get children away into government programs at the earliest age possible. And they also said they'd like to get behind the feminist movement because they felt it had been very successful and making women discontent with marriage and motherhood. To destroy business, they wanted to get behind the environmental movement. And in 1992, the environmental movement was very modest. but they thought it was the only vehicle capable of creating enough regulation and red tape to discourage business growth. And finally, to destroy our culture of religion and morality, they said, if we could get Americans to accept homosexuality, they thought it would begin to extinguish our traditional moral values Americans held. I remember thinking at the time, this plan doesn't seem very realistic. It's not something I'll need to worry about in my lifetime. It was 15 years later, I was appointed by the governor to be a state representative in the legislature. I'd only lived in my district for 2 years, so I thought it'd be a good idea if I wrote a monthly letter to the editor. Each month I wrote on a different topic. In January 2008, as I was contemplating what to write my letter on, I thought back to the meeting in 1992, and I thought of the goals they'd outlined and where America was today, and I couldn't believe how successful they had been. I mean, our families were totally disintegrating. The environmental movement had become the most powerful force for destroying our free markets, and hate crimes legislation was being considered in Washington, D.C. that made it a crime to even say anything against the homosexual movement. I realized people needed to know what was going on. After I wrote this letter, within days, people were protesting at the Capitol. It was the feature story on the evening news.
Controversial comments have state legislators buzzing tonight.
After a freshman lawmaker alleges the communist agenda has infiltrated mainstream America. It's the big story, live at 6.
And over 40 letters to the editor had been printed in response to what I'd said.
I just wanted to give you support on your newspaper article. Don't let them grind you down. Bye.
I realized then I'd hit on something. One of the letters written in my defense stated that a book from 1958 had outlined a similar agenda. And this got my attention. The book was The Naked Communist by Cleon Skousen, who had been a former FBI agent. And inside the book, it documented 45 current communist goals from 1958. And as I slowly read through the list, seeing how specific their agenda had been to subvert us on the inside, I couldn't believe it. Accomplished almost every single one of them, and nobody seemed to be noticing. For at least the last 50 years, they've been working actively behind the scenes, in the shadows, trying to move our people and our culture in a direction that was designed to destroy us. Someone needed to find out the truth of what had happened to our country. Could all of these very specific goals have been accomplished by accident? Or was there something there, under the surface, intentionally rotting away America's culture? I decided to go and get the facts from some of my favorite writers and speakers around the country. These are a few of the questions I asked them.
Thank you. is dead, but there are more Communist Party members in the world today than there ever have been.
One of the things the Communists are doing worldwide is not using that name. And so what we have is people with some of the same ideas masquerading in the United States under a variety of names. They're even trying to get away from the word liberal to describe them, and they're trying to call themselves progressives.
If you go to the American Communist Party website, all of the programs and policies they support are progressive.
So progressives are anything from a hardcore liberal to a communist to a socialist. They all call themselves progressives. And they all have broadly the same values and work together.
J. Edgar Hoover's called the masters of deceit. And a good magician raises one hand in the air while he's doing his dirty work with the other hand. And while everybody's saying communism has died, they moved through much of Africa.
Communism is resurgent in South Africa.
Into South and Central America.
Right now, six countries in Latin America are now communistic. We have communist China. We have Cuba, North Korea. We have Vietnam.
It still dominates behind the scene in Russia. It's still very strong in Eastern Europe. It's strong in the EU. It is strong in virtually every country in the world.
Whitaker Chambers said, communism succeeds because most people that promote communist causes are not communists. The useful idiots that Lenin called them, it gives it an air of legitimacy it would never have if it was identified with communists and communism.
So why has it been so easy for them to get people on the left who aren't communists to push forward their agenda? Once I looked at the political scale, it all started to make sense. On the far left, you have 100% government, and on the far right, zero government. Anarchy is no government. It doesn't make sense at all. On the far left, you have socialism, communism, and Nazism. All systems that have a socialist form of government with only slight variances between them. Traditionally, Republicans were slightly to the right of center, and Democrats were slightly to the left. In recent years, though, through the radical influence of the media, Hollywood, and the multitude of Marxist professors in our universities, both parties have slid to the left, with the Democrats going so far, they have openly joined hand in hand with the radicals. That's why they all work together. All the groups on the left now have the same goal, a socialist America.
I thought we were over communism. I thought, okay, we won that battle. The Berlin Wall came down. Ronald Reagan won the day. We've got to look and see how he fought this, because we're fighting again on American soil. Not hostily attacking us like we feared in the Cold War. It is from within.
And it has no opposition. None. And that's a frightening thing.
I think it's pretty clear to see communism isn't dead. They now disguise it by calling it different names, but the ideas behind it are alive and well. Almost 1.5 billion people still live in openly communistic countries. But unfortunately, most of us in America who are under the age of 50 have no idea what communism means to the people who live under it. So my next question was, what's so bad about communism?
Communism is so evil.
It's a completely tyrannical system. The whole history of communism is one of mass murder.
Tens of millions of people brutally murdered by the communists.
The mass murder of more people in times of peace than all the wars of history combined.
Each of those countries where they have taken control, millions have been murdered.
When you're asking for what is the legacy of Marxism, it is the greatest killing machine in all of human history.
We're talking a congressional record, 135 million dead due to communism. I think the real number is probably, when you add in abortions, over 500 million. The rulers lived rather well,
And at the same time, you had all kinds of people who were enslaved, put in prison, oppressed. So you had the opposite of what they claimed was going to be the result of their revolutionary activity.
You would think that if the 20th century was the most murderous of centuries, everyone would say, let's find out why. And the truth is, came and asked the question. It is verboten to ask the question because the ideas that brought about that mass murder are still being taught in our public schools today.
I think one of the reasons this has happened is because there's so much confusion surrounding the word communism. Technically speaking, communism is simply the final phase and goal of socialism. And socialism is best described by two words, big government. Government controls almost everything, and they use this power to take things by force from one person and give it to another. The liberals in America sincerely believe that this isn't evil at all. It is what will finally make things fair and just. There's only one problem that pulls some of us away from this wonderful utopian vision. History. From history we see that whether it was Hitler's National Socialism or Stalin's Soviet Socialism, socialism, by whatever name and in all its forms, is the ultimate evil. Sooner or later, it destroys everything in its path. Law, morality, family, prosperity, productivity, education, incentive, and finally life itself. The problem with socialism is that it creates the conditions for a Stalin or a Hitler to come to power. Has such relevance today. It's the final destination on the road we're traveling. Friedrich Nietzsche tried to convince the world that God was dead. Charles Darwin tried to prove that humans are simply part of the animal kingdom. And Karl Marx realized that the philosophies of Nietzsche and Darwin would legitimize his own philosophy of communism. He knew their ideas would justify the brutality and slaughter that would be necessary to implement communism worldwide. It was in March of 1883, Karl Marx, the father of modern-day communism, died. The assumption that communism would die with him was a logical one, since only 9 people attended his funeral. In October of that same year in London, England, a group was forming called the Fabian Socialist Society.
The Fabian Socialists decided that they were going to socialize the world incrementally. They called it socialism by evolution instead of Marxist socialism by revolution.
It always worked in tandem with the communists. Some Fabians were also communists. There was a bit of interchange in membership.
The Fabian Socialists are slowly but surely bringing about the socialization of the world. Europe is pretty well done. They are not working in Latin America. Latin America is not just socialistic in many countries. They're all already Marxist. You have a hardcore Marxism in Venezuela and Nicaragua. El Salvador just went communistic. And of course, Fidel is sitting right there laughing at this whole thing. And we haven't even figured this thing out yet. We don't even know there's a red plague coming out to meet us. We think that we're just going to watch the cartoons on Saturday morning and everything will be fine.
They had a lot to do with bad stuff happening.
There are 2 things I found that gave me a good idea where the Fabians were really coming from. First of all, their symbol was a wolf in sheep's clothing. And secondly, George Bernard Shaw, who was a leader in the Fabians for almost 50 years, said, quote, "I am a communist, but not a member of the Communist Party. Stalin is a first-rate Fabian. I am one of the founders of Fabianism, and as such, very friendly to Russia," unquote.
Fabians eventually beget Students for Democratic Society, which beget the Weather Underground, which beget the basically the social changes that have happened in America in the last 40 years.
Many of the SDS members from the 1960s still have an incredible influence on the direction our country is heading. One is the Reverend Jim Wallace, who was president of SDS when he was a student at Michigan State University.
And yet today, he is the spiritual advisor to the President of the United States. They've been friends for many years. They go back to Chicago and the Chicago politics crowd. And during the Vietnam War, he was rooting for the Viet Cong to beat the United States Army. And when they did, he just couldn't believe it. He said it was one of the happiest days in his life.
And another leader in the Students for a Democratic Society and founder of the Weather Underground is William Ayers, who has been a longtime friend and neighbor of President Obama's. It came out in 2009 that Obama's book, Dreams from My Father, was even written by Ayers. So the influence from the Fabian Socialist Society goes right into the White House. The next group I found that has seriously impacted America's culture is the Frankfurt School.
The Frankfurt School was a sort of an outpost in America of European socialism.
William Munzenberg, with a few other Bolsheviks, founded the Frankfurt School.
The two leading members were Herbert Marcuse and Franz Neumann. Franz Neumann was, in fact, a Soviet agent.
Their entire purpose was to stand the entire educational system of the West, and the United States in particular, on its head.
Bertrand Russell, who worked with the Frankfurt School, said, by using psychological techniques to teach the children, we will be able to produce, quote, an unshakable conviction that snow is black, unquote.
They established a school here
with the help of John Dewey. He helps bring these German intellectuals to America in 1933. Dropped them down at Princeton, Berkeley, Brandeis, to go after education and media.
Included in those goals were the teaching of homosexuality and sexuality to children, the promotion of excessive drinking, and destruction of religion in the United States. That was a big one.
And they basically started the social rot.
Willie Munzberg said, we are going to make the West so corrupt it stinks.
I love spending time with my family, July 4th, baseball, right? In my mind can't even comprehend that there were groups of intellectuals back in the 1930s plotting and planning how they could make America so corrupt it stinks.
There are certain lines and certain limits, and the left has always pushed it as hard as they can, as far as they can, and will protect any pornographer, any deviant, any negative cultural form they can find, basically to degrade the culture.
And that goes right along with the feminism of today, which was part of the Frankfurt School's desire to destroy a patriarchal society for a matriarchal society. In other words, remove the father as the loving provider, discipliner, discipler, leader of his home, where you instill virtues and integrity and modesty. That's been broken down on purpose, because they knew if they could destroy the family, they could destroy a nation. And instead of having a father who leads and disciples and protects the home and provides for the family, the government steps in as a nanny state.
The Frankfurt School developed the concept of cultural Marxism.
Penetrate your culture, take it over, and then everything else will fall.
And of course they did that, and today we've had a complete cultural revolution. As many people in America are familiar with the phrase, make love, not war, that actually came from Herbert Marcuse, who was with the Frankfurt School. So these guys went after education, they went after media, and they've been very successful in changing the entire worldview of Americans through what they call political correctness. But it's really cultural Marxism, with the goal being to destroy Christianity, then create chaos, and then move to their ultimate goal, which is from cultural Marxism to traditional Marxism, which is socialism.
Most of the strategy to remake America from within started with Antonio Gramsci, who wrote over 2,000 pages back in the 1930s outlining how to take a Judeo-Christian culture down from the inside. The plan he suggested has been the main focus of the left ever since.
Antonio Gramsci was a neo-Marxist philosopher.
Antonio Gramsci was an Italian communist.
Antonio Gramsci is probably the biggest troublemaker in the world. He's probably got more responsibility for our social ills than anybody else on the planet.
He knew of the importance of undermining the morals in the character of this country.
Because America had a strong Christian heritage, you had to attack the culture. You had to change the culture.
Even to pornography and the areas that most people normally wouldn't accept.
He said that we're going to destroy the West by destroying its culture. We're going to infiltrate and we're going to turn their music, their art, and their literature against them.
That means that you penetrate the universities, you write the books, the novels, the poetry, the music, the book reviews. And once you control the culture, then you can sort of shape the thought of rising generations.
He differed with Marx. Instead of, for example, destroying the church and the other basic institutions, he said infiltrate them and use them to change the culture.
What Gramsci had to say was that this is the way that government is perpetuated and society is perpetuated, is through these churches, because they set the standards, they set the framework of the way people live, of rules, how families should be structured.
He didn't want a revolution on the streets that would be overturned by the police the next day. He wanted to change society over the long term so that we'd have a revolution without us even realizing it, basically.
And the communists have been very effective in promoting their ideology in Hollywood, in the mass media.
And I think he was quite right. I think that's exactly what has happened. I think that's what's worked. I think it's working right now. And that's where a lot of these people come from.
And that's been the big success story of communism in the last 50 years. It's the professors, it's the educationalists, it's the journalists. They are the shock troops, the Gramscian shock troops of the future.
And one of Gramsci's all-star disciples, Saul Alinsky, became one of the most influential radicals of the 1960s.
Well, Saul Alinsky was a prominent radical in 1930s Chicago. He worked closely with the Communist Party. He used to go down and train at the rifle range with Leon Dupre, who was later a mentor of Barack Obama. They used to train to shoot because they knew the revolution was just around the corner. But that didn't come, so he got a bit more subtle.
Well, Saul Alinsky called for a community organizer to stir things up, to create agitation. In fact, he said you'd be accused of being an agitator, and that's exactly what you are. He wanted the haves and have-nots fighting with each other.
It wasn't until I was watching an old film from World War II that I realized what the left has been doing in America to pit the poor against the rich, blacks against whites, and the young against the old, is the same tactic Hitler used to disunify Germany.
You see, they knew that they were not strong enough to conquer a unified country. So they split Germany into small groups. They used prejudice as a practical weapon to cripple the nation. Remember that when you hear this kind of talk. Somebody is going to get something out of it, and it isn't going to be you.
And they use the conflict as justification for more government to stop the chaos. So they create the chaos, and then they step in as a solution to the chaos. And as Francis Schaeffer said, once this chaos comes, most people will willingly give over to an authoritarianism because they don't want the chaos. His book was kind of the field manual, if you will, for these activist organizations, which President Obama studied and taught at a workshop for 4 years in Chicago as a community organizer for ACORN.
As I was reading through Rules for Radicals to see where he was coming from, I just happened to take a look at the dedication in the front of the book. And this is what I saw. Quote, "Lest we forget at least an over-the-shoulder acknowledgement to the very first radical, the first radical known to man who rebelled against the establishment and did it so effectively that he at least won his own kingdom, Lucifer." Unquote. Saul Alinsky, from Antonio Gramsci, has had an incredible amount of influence on our president and on our society. And he dedicates his book openly to Lucifer, Satan. I think that says more about where their ideas and plans are based than anything else.
You asked what Saul Alinsky's impact is on the leftist movement today, and it basically defines it. It defines it.
Saul Alinsky took the best of Gramsci and the best of the Fabian socialist ideas, combined, repackaged, and sold them to the 60s radicals. After studying Alinsky, Richard Clower and his wife, Frances Fox Piven, came up with what is today known as the Clower-Piven strategy.
Now, their idea was basically that to destroy society or destroy capitalism per se, they needed to overload the system. The idea was to get everybody you possibly could on welfare, to get everybody you possibly could basically milking the system in some way or another.
It was called the crisis strategy, and it became very well known by activists and radicals in the 60s. They published an article in the May 1966 issue of Nation magazine called The Weight of the Poor, in which they outlined their strategy.
Rathke read that article, and Rathke ended up starting what we now know today as ACORN. And of course, Clower and Piven had been studying Saul Alinsky. So Antonio Gramsci gives us Saul Alinsky. Saul Alinsky gives us the Clower and Piven strategy, this husband and wife that said, hey, let's collapse the American economy by implementing so many entitlements, so much of a welfare state collapse. Rathke studied the Clower and Piven strategy. He starts ACORN.
And of course, ACORN gave us Obama. And to show what a small world it is, Wade Rathke, who started ACORN, was the draft resistance organizer for SDS, the group the Fabians started.
They've used that strategy ever since to expand voting rolls, to expand welfare rolls wherever they can, basically just to overload the system, to increase the tax burden on the middle class, and basically bring capitalism one step closer to destruction.
I guess we shouldn't be surprised that we still have open borders, that so many people are dependent on the government, and that the left keeps pushing these programs when all they've done is tear apart the black families in America and create generational cycles of poverty. The last group that has worked alongside the Fabians and the Frankfurt School using Gramsci's approach is the Communist Party USA.
Probably the most important book on this subject is called Towards Soviet America by William Z. Foster. William Z. Foster was the head of the Communist Party himself. He ran for the President of the United States in 1932, but in the book Towards Soviet America, he literally lays out chapter by chapter by chapter what is entailed to bring about a USSA, not just a USSR.
Two of the movements they started in America have played a significant role in tearing apart our families, in breaking down our morality.
Betty Friedan is credited with really starting the feminist movement in this country. The purpose really was to attack full-time homemakers, to get them out of the home, to make them think they live dreary lives, to make women feel they are victims. It's the science of victimology. And that is so unfortunate, because the American woman is the most fortunate class of people who ever lived on the face of the earth. And to try to tell them that they are victims of an oppressive, unjust patriarchy is just a grievous lie. But unfortunately, they are teaching young women that and have been doing it for many years.
While Betty Friedan was pushing her book, Feminine Mystique, she implied that she was coming from the point of being a frustrated housewife herself and just wanted to be a help to other women. But later in the 1990s, it came out she was in fact a radical propagandist for the Communist Party and a staunch supporter of Stalin. So when she had described the American family as, quote, a comfortable concentration camp, unquote, it wasn't because of her experience at home. It was because she was just doing her part to dismantle our families.
I'm a student of communism, and the communists set up various groups and various societies. Their society that they set up to promote homosexuality in this country was called the Mattachine Society. And it was founded by Henry Hay, a leading member of the Communist Party. So since I was studying communism and teaching on the issue of communism, you just follow leads, and all of a sudden you realize, what is this Mattachine? I've never heard of this Mattachine Society. Well, it was Henry Hay's organization set up to infiltrate the culture of the United States to make homosexuality normal.
It's always been a movement dominated by the left. It's all these so-called isms, you'll find there's a communist or a socialist behind every one of them, and you'll always see the targets. It's basically the traditional family unit.
The war is still against the family. If you go back to the Communist Manifesto and read Karl Marx carefully, the war is against what they called the bourgeois family, which was really the biblical family, father, mother, and child.
They want to plow through marriage. They want to change the very definition and meaning of marriage, because their open door to engineering society in this utopian way is blocked by the very values of our Christian civilization that's taught through marriage.
And so the left just has got to destroy the family, because if there's any one thing that will prevent the left from carrying out its agenda, it's healthy and strong nuclear families.
And so from the Fabian Socialist Society to the Frankfurt School to Antonio Gramsci and the Communist Party USA, from these four, you will find connections to almost every left-leaning person and organization in America. Their influence has been incredible. It was in the 1960s, all the groups on the left seemed to realize Antonio Gramsci was right. In a Judeo-Christian society, you will never be able to persuade people to rise up in a Marxist revolution and start killing each other off. The only way to take the culture down is through penetrating the institutions of influence to change the people from within. I guess the biggest surprise I had while studying these four groups was seeing that a large part of their agenda was trying to make us an immoral people.
The communists knew in the 1930s and since that time, and the leftists know today, that if you can break down the cultural traditions, the basic rules of morality, then it's much easier to move people in different directions that are counter to the good of society.
They recognize that it's all part of the same fabric. Their ideologies all work together to break down families, to break down the sanctity of human life, the value of human life, to break down the idea that there is a God that we are accountable to.
They essentially are validated in the Judeo-Christian worldview by the very things they attack. Because in their effort to destroy our culture, they know that they have to go after the very things that the Judeo-Christian tradition honors and values. Morality, belief in God, faith, the importance of family, the sanctity of life, the sanctity of marriage.
It's amazing our enemies could see our morality was our greatest strength. And yet so many Americans don't seem to get it. Morality is simply having the character to do what you should do instead of what you have the freedom to do. And that's the only way freedom works. A people cannot be given freedom without morality, or they will self-destruct. And that's what we see happening in America today. The bottom line is, freedom and free enterprise are simply fruit on the tree of morality. Our founding fathers clearly understood this principle, and so do our enemies. is an important fact we need to face. If we had Ronald Reagan as president, low taxes, and a strong national defense, the ship certainly wouldn't be sinking as fast as it is now, but it would still be sinking. A booming economy doesn't take care of the major problems we face. 50% of all marriages end in divorce. 40% of all children born out of wedlock. Over 3,000 women a day aborting their babies. 19 million new cases each year of sexually transmitted diseases. Schools that teach the children, everything is relative. There is no right or wrong. And the list goes on and on. I recently read in our local paper that over the last 12 months, almost 7% of all high school students in my state tried to commit suicide. Our society is falling apart, whether we want to admit it or not. Had the insight to see that dethroning God and destroying capitalism went hand in hand. As you attempt to dethrone God by erasing the morality in the society and destroying his institutions, the family and the church, you are destroying capitalism. Because as the families fall apart and the church loses its influence, society starts to crumble. And then government has to expand to pick up the pieces.
The question, as Whitaker Chambers put it, was God or man? God or man?
Karl Marx was an atheist. Marx's philosophy was that people existed for the benefit of the state.
What Marxism did and does, and all the other isms of the modern era, is to try to dethrone God by deifying man.
You have to discredit God. Is your competition.
The 20th century ushered in several ideologies that sought to devalue God and elevate man. Communism, relativism, humanism, they all deny that there's a God, and they claim that by doing so they're really elevating man. But if you look at how each of those philosophies end up working out in real life, there are always some classes of human beings that don't deserve the same value or rights as anyone else.
To turn it around, to believe in freedom where we have been raised, you have to believe that there's something precious about every human person. And of course, that's from the Bible, the Imago Dei. We are all created in the image of God. Therefore, every human being is entitled to respect and dignity and freedom, and that is distinctive to biblical religion. You don't find anywhere else.
Almost all the ideas that have made America such a unique and great country, our founding fathers got straight out of the Bible. I guess that's why the left only has a problem with one religion, biblical Christianity. They never complain about separation of church and state when it comes to Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, or any of the other religions. In fact, a couple years ago, the Dalai Lama came to my town, and during the school day, at taxpayers' expense, thousands of our local school children were bused in to hear him talk. I wonder if they would ever do that for someone like Billy Graham. No, they must destroy the Bible's influence in America so they can step in with big government in its place.
It's an age-old question. Are we going to believe in God, or are we going to play God ourselves?
Essentially, for the left, the choice that they see very clearly is people are going to depend upon God or they are going to depend upon government. They want people to depend upon government, so they have to destroy faith in God.
At its core, it's a rebellion against God and God's laws.
And that's what the battle is about. That's what the assault is on. That's why Christianity is a target.
And that's why we saw the gulags in the Soviet Union. We saw the concentration camps in Nazi Germany. And all the ideologies that elevate man end up devaluing certain human beings.
dictators of the left, Hitler, Stalin, Mao, Castro, and all the others, always have come to power by acting like they're going to change things to make it better for the people. Yet history has shown us the devastating results that have happened every single time. There is no example in history of big government that didn't abuse its power over the people. But people who have believed in the God of the Bible and that our rights are a gift from Him to everyone have always stood up for the preciousness of every human life.
You look at those who have fought for true human rights throughout the ages, and it's those that do have a strong faith in God, those who fought against slavery, and those now today who are fighting for the sanctity of human life.
Like the Declaration says, well, your holy truth will be self-evident, all men are created. Aristotle didn't believe that. He said some people are born to be slaves, and some other people are born to rule over them. And the reason that you and I know different